So, first of all, I should thank all the organizers for inviting me and to have the possibility to participate at this at the summer school, and especially in this panel of system thinking. I'd like to make one contribution to that. So, professionally I am architectural theorist. I came from the institute which is called Center for Theoretical Study, which is located in Prague. It's a joint institution of Charles University in Prague and Academy of Sciences of the Czech Republic. It's a relatively small institute. We are about 20 people, but maybe what is a bit extraordinary that we are really very diverse group of people. We had biologists there, we have mathematicians, physicists, but also sociologists, anthropologists, and art historians. So that's the quite interesting group of people. Of course, everyone has its own projects, but we have also one, let's say, a common ground, common research project, which is concentrated on so-called complex phenomena in natural and social sciences. I think that maybe one thing about our institute is that I should mention our biologist, because maybe especially people like David Storff and Petr Kyle or Petr Pokorny now are somehow on the wave of interest, because they published some important papers in Nature and in PLOS ONE and PNAS. So this part of our institute makes some kind of, let's say, world-class research, and I'm really enjoying the collaboration with them. We are this sort of transdisciplinary institution, and this word transdisciplinarity is today some kind of fashion word, and often it doesn't mean anything real. This moments of real cooperation, of real collaboration, of real transit of knowledge or transit of approaches between disciplines are very rare. And today I want to tell you one story where this transdisciplinarity was really effective. It's probably for some of you a famous story, or probably you know some of the chapters, but I hope not all of you. It's the story about, let's say, mutual inspiration between urban theory and between biology. This story begins more about 100 years ago by this book on growth and form by Darcy Bedford Thompson. I'm not sure if you know this name. Probably for some of you who don't, I just want to tell some biographical comments. He was really extraordinary man, not in kind of, so if we want to categorize him in some discipline, so it's quite impossible. There is a foreword of this book by famous biologist Stephen Jay Gould, which is called "This Was a Man." It's a quotation from Shakespeare, and this word were addressed to Julius Caesar, but it holds very well for Darcy and for Thompson as well. These words are the elements so mixed in him that nature might stand up and say to all the world, "This was a man." His was a man in such kind that he combined very diverse disciplines together. He was very good in biology, but also in mathematics and in classics as well. he spoke, I don't know, seven languages, also the classic one he translated from Greek, and all this is very good visible in his text, so you can really enjoy the literary qualities of his text. He worked in small universities in Scotland, and he was not so, let's say, successful or famous in his time, but today, let's say in last, definitely last 10 years, but maybe more, we are witnessing a great revival of interest to his work. Some pictures with his laboratory and his study just for the after the lunch for refreshing. He was a great collector of natural objects. He actually created a collection for the museum in Dundee. There are some objects from his scientific expeditions, this from Bering Sea. So he was interested in different, let's say, natural objects in its forms, in their forms, and in their way of growing. And that's why the title of the book, on growth and But what was probably the most important thing by him was he really attempted to make some fundamental shift in biology. For him, biology of that time was too isolated, too much concentrated on, let's say, its problems, on its way of explaining things, and neglecting the basic, just basic thing like that all the natural bodies are also material bodies, physical ones, and that they should obey law of physics at the same time as stones and other objects. So maybe some quotations which are quite interesting from him. Even now, so at that time, the zoologist has scarce begun to dream of defining in mathematical language even the simplest organic forms. When he meets with a simple geometrical construction, for instance in the honeycomb, he would fain refer to it. He would fain refer it to psychical instinct or to skill or ingenuity rather than to the operation of physical forces or mathematical laws. When he sees in snail or nautilus or tiny foraminifera or radiolarian shell claw a close approach to sphere or spiral, he is prone of all habit to believe that after all it's something more than a spiral or sphere, and that in this something more there lies what neither mathematics nor physics can explain. Cell and tissue, shell and bone, leaf and flower are so many portions of matter, and it is in obedience to the laws of physics that their particles have been moved, mounted, and conformed. There are no exceptions to the rule that God always geometrizes. Their problem of form are in the first instance mathematical problems. Their problems of growth are essentially physical problems, and the morphologist is ipso facto a student of physical science. So that's the key issue. So he wants to somehow put the physics and mathematics into biological science. And how he did it, we will follow through this, let's say, first chapter of the story. So the key idea in his book is, let's say, thinking in forces and dimensions. That's something what is probably quite trivial in physics, but really unconventional and maybe really extraordinary in biology, at least at that time. So think about any form, any biological form, any animal or plant as a result of forces. So if we want to study this object, we have to at the first time consider the forces, the complex of forces that are relevant for this property. then we should recognize dimensions that play a key role in action of these forces. And then, and that's maybe, let's say, step further beyond the physics, because living organisms are dynamic bodies, we have to think about effects of size. So it means what will happen with these properties of animals or plants when its size will change. What will happen with the properties and what will happen with these dimensions? So this thinking in these effects of sizes is important for biological organisms, of course, in two respects. Because one respect is that, of course, every individual organism is growing, changing the size, and the second respect is that we can compare the different organisms that have different size. We can compare, let's say, one property, how it is realized in these different organisms of different size. So, if we want to think about change of size in this physical approach, physical as Darcy or Thompson think about that. So what does it mean to think really dimensionally? So it's a quite obvious thing, nothing special about that. Only in biology it's very rare. So what does it say? When the size changes, of course, the length changes one-dimensionally, surface changes two-dimensionally, and volume three-dimensionally. So, if we can imagine an organism who would just change the size proportionally, like balloon, just blow up, so it means the change in every direction the same, of course, the lines will change only one-dimensionally, the surfaces two-dimensionally, so it increases as the square of the line, and the volumes will increase as a cube of the line. So there is a disproportion. The surfaces grow much more smaller than volumes, much more slower than volumes, when the growth happen proportional. That's all the problem of proportionality in the animals and in trees and in plants. So it's actually this problem. So let's look at this problem more detailed, really in the text, the first chapter of the book on growth of form, which is called On Magnitude, size, let's say. And this chapter begins with very interesting metaphor. This one. It follows at once that if we build two bridges geometrically similar, the larger is the weaker of the two. And one couple of lines further, to come back to homelier things, the strength of an iron girder obviously varies with the cross-section of its members. So, we have here this problem of proportions, and we will follow that in a minute. But I want to just mention that quite important thing is that if he or Darcy Thompson wants to introduce his new way of thinking in biology, he uses exactly this metaphor from engineering, from physics. So that's the first part of the story, biology inspired by, let's say, physics, or you can say architecture. If we want to really follow these analogies, we have to, let's say, do something or avoid something. First, what we should avoid is this classical dichotomy of nature and culture. Here, there is no such difference. For Darcy Thompson, physis and techne, natural phenomena and let's say artificial phenomena have their structure, and he wants to study the similarity in structure, in their structure. There is no difference between them. The second thing is the maybe we have to avoid maybe very traditional thinking about sizes. If we think about sizes, we should say size is a relative characteristic, it's a relative property. If I say this is small, I should always relate it to something other. It's smaller than me, but it's bigger than some particle in water, etc. So usually size is a relative characteristic. Darcy Thompson uses the famous quotation from Gulliver, from his Gulliver Travels, and you know that, and Gulliver meet the Lilliputians and then the giants from Brumbinjak, and then there is a sentence that after these experiences he should recognize that philosophers had the right to say that nothing is great or little otherwise than by comparison. So it means sizes, relative characteristics. However, in nature and in not in fiction but in real human society, the size behaves often as absolute quality, and that's very important. So what does it mean? It means that with change of size, the fundamental qualities of the object change as well. So it's not as innocent to just zoom in and zoom out the objects. It's not possible to do it like that. Quite the opposite. We can say that every animal and every plant has something like its own scale, which creates, let's say, dimension of its life. And it's impossible to just to take it and to put it to another dimension. If we will do that, then we would have to change the properties of the animal. And that's what Darcy Thompson want to say us. I should mention some of the exceptions of this rule that dimensions are absolute. Of course, we have in nature also the objects like that, let's say scale-free objects that really regardless of the scale, we always got the same image. If we zoom in this, we probably get something very similar. But I don't want to speak about this kind of objects, let's say, or I will speak about them, but in the second part of my lecture in the afternoon. I will now concentrate on this object, like bridges or elephants, which are really scale dependent, and we will see how. Just very simple thing, and I'm sorry to be maybe very trivial, but I want to concentrate on general characteristics. So for the physicist in the auditorium, so be patient. If we have a bridge, the basic properties is needed for its carrying capacity? It's a material, then type of construction, we have several of them here, and the third one is they are the proportions, robustness of the construction. And the same holds for the skeleton for all mammals, let's say. Only difference is that by all mammals, material of their skeleton and type of construction is always the same or very similar. And only thing which is different is the proportion of the skeleton. It's the proportion of the construction system of their bodies. So think about the robustness of construction. So, and then what does it mean in Darcy Thompson's perspective? It means, what does it mean in respect to forces and in respect to dimensions? So robustness of construction is given by the cross-section of its members, for example, the girders. And this robustness is affected by the weight of the whole construction. So we have these two forces, so one which, let's say, holds all the construction together, and another one, gravitation, which wants to crash it. So in dimensions, for the cross-section, the key role plays the surface. For the weight, the volume. So we have this disproportion, two dimensions for the forces which holds the bridge together, and three dimensions for the forces who threaten to crash it. So when the size of the bridge would change just simply proportionally, like balloon, blow up the balloon, the cross-section would grow more slowly than the weight. And it would result in disproportion of robustness and weight, and with further growth, the object probably will crash. So that's the main lesson. The carrying capacity of the two bridges of the same construction relatively drops when we change the size, or when we take the bigger one. So that's the reason why we cannot simply blow up bridges as balloons. We have to somehow compensate this disproportion. And how to compensate it? So we again have three possibilities. We can change the material, we can change the construction system, or we can change the robustness. And how to change the robustness? So it means we somehow have to make the thing that the cross-section will grow in the same proportion as the weight. So the that's the same problem in different phenomena. It needn't be the bridges. The same problem we have with apple, because also we have some weight of the apple, gravitation forces, and we have a stalk, so this part of the apple connect the apple to the tree. And again, we can have this problem. When this complex, so the upper apple with the stalk, would grow proportionally, then the apple will crash or will fall down from the tree. To avoid that, we have to somehow arrange, and nature will arrange it, that the cross-section of the stalk will grow disproportionately, so much more faster than the apple itself. And again, the same is with the elephant. We have his head and the neck. So the bigger the animal is, the more robust neck it should have. Otherwise, it should not carry the very heavy head it has. So that's the whole thing. But it's quite simple. Quite simple, and I just want to show you then the consequences of that thinking. And these consequences are really infinite. That's the beauty of this way of thinking. Maybe not the details, but the possibilities that it has. In physics, that is the same problem. Just with artificial objects, so we have gravitational force of weight and the strength of fire. Again, this is relative to the surface, to two dimensions. Weight is relative to volume, so so to three dimensions, and when we change the size, so it increases as a cube and it increases as a square, and there we have this this proportion. This can be expressed as a like general law, and it was expressed as a general law, so-called principle of similitude or dynamical similarity, and it says that if we want to have two objects really structurally similar, we have to make something with it, we have to change the proportions. Otherwise, the properties of the systems would be completely different. And this law was formulated already by Galileo, so in 17th century, and it's really universal law holding both for living and non-living objects. And what it really says is that neither animal nor building cannot grow infinitely when it wants to remain in the proportion. It would crash but its own weight when it just lower as balance. Some of the quite interesting numbers, when we change the robustness of skeleton of animals, then the proportion of skeleton to the whole volume of the animal is so different, and we can see that by small animals skeleton makes only a small part of the whole volume of the mouse, only 8%, and when the animals is growing and the human being, so we have it's 18%, so 18% of us is our skeleton. So there are these are the consequences. Yeah. Bigger animals have more of their volume is hardy bones. Bigger animals have stronger and shorter legs, stronger and shorter, more robust, and they are generally slower, generally clumsy. Think about mouse, how fast it is, and think about elephant, how slow. The other consequences are the question about limits of size. The question is, are there any limits in nature, limits of robustness, limits of compensating this basic disproportion, this physical disproportion? And yes, probably they are. They are, when we take, for example, the trees, there are not infinitely high trees, and maybe the some kind of border or some kind of limit is about 100 meters. These sequoias, some beautiful sequoias in one park in the Czech Republic. We have actually in the Czech Republic about five of these trees, and three of them are in this park in the central Bohemia. This 100 meter is probably the limit for trees. There is nice quotation in the book of Darcy Thompson from Johann Wolfgang Goethe: "Es ist dafür gesorgt, dass die Bäume nicht in den Himmel wachsen." So it means that trees cannot grow into the sky. And of course, for trees hold everything what we have said about animals. So the more robust trees are, smaller trees are more robust. Trees were also, which is interesting for this metaphor with architectural analogies with architecture, trees were exactly the model for first tower construction. Also, there were some optimization after that, because trees, when we take this curve of the of the tree, so they somehow it's aligned, because in opposition to the, for example, Eiffel Tower, is the logarithmic curve, which has a better properties, better static properties in this way. Okay, only maybe just to mention it that for, of course, these limits do not hold for the sea animals, because there is another force that that compensates this disproportion, and this is buoyant force. But we can let's do the next topic. We can really generalize what we have said up to this point. There is some disproportion between growth of volume and surface in the animal, and this disproportion of growth with thighs says that the bigger the animal is, the bigger role the volume and the weight plays in it. And then we can say that the by smaller animals, the bigger role makes the surface. So we can somehow speak about volume-like and surface-like animals. And just for the thumb, of course, there is some difference between them. The small one, even everything or the basic things plays on the surface, and we can enjoy this nice volume-like animals like here. So the size really matters in nature. Size really decides about form and about behavior of animals and about behavior or functioning of plants. What are the consequences? Other consequences, and I had already said that these consequences are infinite. Are infinite, and just want to show you three of them. You can enjoy it in full detail in the book of Darcy Thompson, which is, I think, you can find it online on the internet. So one consequence is strength. If we compare different animals or animals of different size, small animals are relatively stronger. Beetle is stronger than dog, is stronger than horse. What does it mean? Of course, not absolutely. Of course, a horse can carry more kilograms than beetle, but relatively, it means to the unit of its weight, it is the opposite. This is already known long time ago, and we can, for example, read in Carl Linné, a famous biologist, if an elephant were as strong in proportion as stag beetle, but the beetle is, it would be able to pull up rocks and level mountains. And if it was the case, probably the big animals would cause the early desolation of the world, as Kirby and Spence says in 1826. So, smaller animals are stronger. Second very interesting property is jumping. And so again, smaller animals are, let's say, faster, and they jump relatively higher. But what is very interesting, and I don't know if you know that, absolutely all animals jump up more or less to the same height. That's some kind of quite interesting universal law. If you take a flea, if you take a grasshopper, if you take a man, they all jump up about 1 meter. Of course, there are some slightly different, but these differences are absolutely negligible when we take the differences in body sizes of these animals. Yeah, this 1 meter for the flea is 200 times height of its body, for the grasshopper it's 20 times, and for the human it's only half of its her body. This law is called Borelli law, because already Giovanni Borelli in 17th century came with this insight, a very interesting Italian physiologist and mathematician. It's always important that there is this mixture of systematic approaches. Okay. The third very important consequence of this, let's say, effect of size or this proportion law is the topic of intensity of metabolism. All basic metabolic processes in animals, respiration, digestion, etc., take place on surfaces. So it means we have this, we have the same problem here. Bigger animals have relatively smaller surfaces, relatively it means for the unit of their weight. So smaller metabolic capacity to gain, but at the same time to lose the energy. And the compensation, therefore, the metabolism of bigger animals is slower. The smaller animals have to somehow compensate the, especially the heat loss, have larger surface, lose more energy, and that is why they need to produce it more. So they have to have faster metabolism. So smaller animals consume more food relatively. Man eats about 150 of its weight per day, mouse 1/2 of its weight per day. So you can see this really difference in order of magnitude. They produce more energy. You can see some numbers here. That's calories per kilo, which is produced by different animals, and there are ordered by size, from the smaller of course to the bigger one. Smaller animals reproduce themselves faster, so it means they have more offspring than bigger animals. Smaller animals get older faster, so their average lifetime is shorter. And their heart beat faster. So all the metabolic processes are faster. So also the heart is beating faster. But another quite interesting thing you probably know, when we take it absolutely, when we take the number of heartbeats per whole life, then this number is for all the animals the same. We all, so fleas, humans, probably not, but all the mammals have this approximately same number of heartbeats per hour. And these insights were really the foundation of so-called metabolic theory in biology. And then I want to continue with our story about the mutual inspiration between organ systems and biological systems. We should maybe mention some other keystones of metabolic theory before that. This man, Max Rubner, you probably know, he was predecessor of Darcy Thompson, so we are now in 19th century. He was a German physiologist and hygienist, one of the first who was dealing with the problem of metabolism and the role of energy exchange in living organism. It was in 1883 he expressed the hypothesis about the key role of body surface in metabolism, that all the important metabolic processes take place on the surfaces. Intensity of metabolism by birds and mammals is proportionated to the surface of their body because the metabolic processes takes place here. And he recognized also the relationship between the intensity of metabolism and the length of life. So he knows already that the faster the metabolism is, then the shorter the life is. Somehow, the smaller animals somehow consume their energy faster than the big ones. and also he recognized the relationship between intensity of metabolism and size of organism, that the bigger or slow. Another important Max is Max Kleiber. Max Kleiber was Swiss biologist, and he was dealing with the question of energy in animals. He is author of so-called Kleiber law from 30s, and this law say intensity of metabolism in animals is proportionate to third quarter power of their body weight. So it says something very similar what Max Rubner and Alfie Thompson said already, but he quantified it, he said it more exact. Of course, this relationship, you can see it here on the graph, so we have body weight and we have, let's say, the intensity of the organism. So if we take it in, if we plot it on a logarithmic scale, we got the line, so that's the identifier of power law function, and so this power function is somehow relative to this number. It was of course very important to have such a data for dietetical problems, and it was one of the problems that was Max Kleiber interested in. At the same time, what we can find out from this graph is that the whole amount of energy used in life is constant regardless of the size of animal. That's the similar thing as we as I told you about the heartbeats. So there is something like law of equivalent energy, that we all have the same amount of energy for consuming it in the life. And this is quite an interesting law, and in biology it was very important in the next history of this theory. I just now jump to the very recent studies. This is Jim Brown from the Santa Fe Institute. He and his colleagues somehow made a revival of Darcy and Fort Thompson. He and his colleagues connected these keystones of metabolic theory together and made from that some very interesting complex theory, which has even the aspiration for something like the final theory in biology. You can read the articles about final theory in ecology connected with this. I should maybe mention, because I am from the CTS, that also our colleagues, David Schwartz and Patrick Kyle, made some very important contribution to this metabolic theory. This is the white paper from Nature, just recently published. And that's the, let's say, very briefly, the first part of the story. The story that was about the inspiration from engineering, from architecture, from physics to biology. And I'd like to show you also the second direction of this transdisciplinary thing. Because it's quite recent, let's say in last 5 years, a couple of people think about the possibility to apply this metabolic theory that was originally inspired by the architecture, to apply this again to the study of cities. Because cities are also some sort of organisms. They have sort of metabolism, they have energy exchange. They have special transport systems which are somehow similar as the transport systems in our bodies. We somehow can speak about intensity of urban life, we can somehow speak about metabolism. We know that some particular similarities are so known a long time ago. For example, some analogy to this law of equivalent energy in animals that say that the more energy the organism consumes, the less frequent it is. That's the application of this rule on ecology. So if we take the whole kind of species, the so-called system of species, and we compare the energy consumptions between them, so we can say that the more energy the organism consumes, the less frequent it is. And we know that rich countries, it means these countries that consumes more energy than the others, have low birth rate, so it means number of their inhabitants stagnates or drops. So there is some, these kind of analogies are of course known, but there is now some, let's say, attempt to make from it some general theory. What it would be is like metabolic theory for cities. Cities are traditionally compared with organisms, and if you just take some of the books from architecture theory, so you can very often read the words like life of cities, or ecosystem, urban ecosystems, urban metabolisms, etc. But I'm afraid that these are, most of them, they are only vague analogies, nothing really important is behind. But now, what I want to follow, it's not these just metaphor or vague analogies, but really some quantifiable relationship between size, energy consumption, productivity, length of life of cities and animals. So is there really something like urban metabolic theory? And I would like to comment or make some comments on this paper, which is 5 years old. It was published in PNAS. The authors are again the people about Santa Fe Institute, or close to Santa Fe Institute in New Mexico. Geoffrey West was at the time the director. Ruth Bettencourt is also from this institute. And these are the, let's say, the friends. This paper is quite interesting. It works with the recent studies in metabolic theory in biology and wants to somehow test the application to the cities. How was the process of the of their work? They collected really enormous amount of data from the US cities, but also European cities, China cities, so from different continents, and these data were about every possible urban phenomena you can imagine, about energy consumption, economic activity, employment, infrastructure, innovation, criminality, health, and other social phenomena, as for example, walking speed. So how fast we walk in different cities. So even this kind of information you can get. And they collected these data about urban phenomena for all the cities in the region. So they get some general information, not just about individual cities, but about the whole urban system. And they always examine the relationship of these urban phenomena to the size of cities, because the hypothesis is cities as well are scale dependent. We can so reveal some scaling behavior in them. So the important, the most important thing is the scale, the size of the city. Size matters. The size can be, size of city can be measured, of course, by different methods. Here, just for the information, all what will be said about size of cities means the number of inhabitants or population size, which has a correlation to the surface of the city. So, what was the result? For each of the phenomena, each of these social phenomena and phenomena connected with energy and distribution of sources, they plot a graph. On the x-axis we have the size of the city, let's say the population, and on the y-axis we have the epsilon, we have this value of this phenomena. And each point on the graph is one city. So that's the collection of it. They plot it on the log-log scale because they got the lines for the best fit. It's again the power function, and in log-log scale it's a line. Mathematically, something like that. And so the result is there really is a significant regularity, despite of the so huge diversity of cities and huge diversity of parts of the world. There is some universal behavior, all of them. Urban phenomena show everywhere scaling behavior. Everywhere they are dependent on scale, dependent on size. All cities are in this respect structurally similar. However, this similarity is not linear, it's non-linear. The power function is there. So the question is, we have that's the first basic result. There is this significant universal regularity. And the second question is, what kind of regularity it is? So it is, we have this power function, and we want to ask about the exponent, because the exponent is very important. We know from biology that all the biological phenomena scales relatively to this third, fourth, to this special number. So the question is there any such a rule in urban phenomena, or how is it? So general observation is that if we pose the question like that, that there are differences to the biological organism, because the exponent beta is not all the urban phenomena has the same exponent. Or, let's say it more ambitiously, not all the exponents are structurally similar, in opposition to the biology. And the second difference is that not all the exponents are smaller than one. So everything what was important in biology, this rule of disproportion, rule of dynamical similarity in biological organisms, was because the exponent was smaller than one. This sublinearity was very important and caused all the consequences that the bigger animals are more robust and are slower and intensity of their metabolism is slower, etc. So that's because the exponent is smaller than one. Urban phenomena in the opposition are not all the same. They could be divided into three different categories exactly according to the exponent. It means according to the type of relationship between the phenomena and the size of the city. These are the three categories. This is the table of all the phenomena, or part of the phenomena that the team had collected. You can see the patterns, new patterns, innovation in cities, then the economic activity, then the health, criminality, electric consumption, and things which are related to infrastructure. These are the number of observations, sources, and this is the exponent beta. And so we see that only part of it is less than one. Some very big amount of it is bigger than one, and some is around one. And these are the three categories, which is quite interesting. What are the urban phenomena that the exponents are smaller than one? There are always the phenomena that are somehow connected with material infrastructure, gasoline station, road surface, length of electrical cables. So it's always something which is connected with infrastructure and with distribution of material sources. And for this kind of phenomena, it holds that the bigger the city is, the relatively smaller the value of epsilon. It means relatively smaller number of gasoline stations, of road surface, of length of electrical cables in the city is. So in language of economy, it's a typical example of economies of scale. Bigger city saves more. Yeah. And this is typical also for biological organisms. Almost all of the biological organisms behave like that. The second category is the exponent around one, which means the linear relationships between size and this urban phenomena. And these are very often just the individual needs, and that's because they are linear. So everyone, everywhere need a house. Everyone, everywhere need a job. And that's because these numbers are linear. These relationships are linear. More interesting, or probably the most interesting category, is the third one, which can be called so super linear relationship. It says that the bigger the city is, the relatively bigger is the value of epsilon as well. And if we so concentrate on it, so most of them are very special social, let's say social phenomena that have very rare analogies to the biology, criminality or innovation or something like that. Again, in language of economy, this is the example of increasing returns of scale, which means bigger gains more. And it's probably uniquely urban. I've said probably because there are quite recently some papers. I remember one from Jordan Hockey, from the university, I think in Los Alamos. And in these papers, so there was something about superlinearity in biological systems as well. It was in the cases of, for example, by bacteria or by animals where we can identify something like social behavior, where it is something like transfer of information, not transfer of material sources, then probably even there are something like superlinear relationship to the size, but it's quite recent. I'm not quite sure about it. But at the time of the of this paper, which was published in so 5 years ago, was stated that probably the superlinearity is something which is really uniquely urban, which is unique for cities. And of course, this again has a lot of implications, a lot of other consequences. I just want to mention something, and we are approaching to the end of the of this lecture. It's quite interesting that we have this very distinct type of urban phenomena, which behaves structurally completely different, and that these urban phenomena are, from their nature, somehow distinct. So on the one side, phenomena connected with infrastructure and energy distribution, and on the other side, phenomena connected with innovation, sharing of information, and maybe the distribution of immaterial sources. We can always ask what is more important, which kind of phenomena is more important, and the answer is it depends on the type of city. That because, and therefore we don't have only two categories of urban phenomena, we can think about two categories of cities. One category of cities are these ones that are driven by distribution of sources, by material, by energy consumption, by material resources, etc. And these are the traditional industrial cities. On the other side, we have some new sort of cities which are driven by social services, by, let's say, information distribution, by innovation, etc. You can call them technological or services cities as you want to. And these are completely distinct type of them in their behavior, in their form. So all what was said about animals, about trees, we can now apply to them. And it's especially true for the growth of the cities. These two types of cities have not only different present state that are concentrated on material and immaterial sources, but we can expect also different evolution in future. It's just the mathematics. Different structure, different organization or form follow to different regime of growth. That is another lesson from Darcy Thompson. That's what he said, or what he taught us. So different exponent beta gives us different prediction for growth dynamics. If the beta is around 1, then the growth would be exponential. That's this case. And it's a typical example of the Malthusian theory of the exponential growth of population. If the beta is smaller than 1, then the growth of the city follows so-called S-curve or sigmoidal curve. And it means that at the beginning the growth is very fast, then it will slow down, and somehow at one point it will stagnate to the point of saturation. This is also a very old idea, and mathematically François Fergulus already, I think in the half of the 19th century, described this function in demographics. What is important, this is typical for all biological systems. So we take any ecological system, we have this S line, and we have this situation of saturation in population. And it holds for industrial cities as well. So we can predict that all industrial cities in respect to the population size will have or already had some saturation point, and they will grow not more. Very interesting situation is with this cities with exponent beta bigger than one, because there the growth is much more faster than exponential, and is relatively or potentially infinite. Of course, it's potentially only in fiction. In real situation, there are always some limits, limited amount of resources. So this very fast growth is completely unsustainable. And really threatened to make a collapse of the city. It's not as a by the traditional industrial city when we can expect some stagnation. Here we can expect really collapse of the city. But there is some solution of that problem. The solution would be in that. That if these cities would adapt itself in the situation where the growth would be too much fast, that they would adapt itself to another sources. If they would somehow change the initial conditions of the to the situation like that, to the beginning state of the fast growth. And if they would be capable somehow postpone the situation of crisis, to go back and again, go back. So if they would be in state of steady adaptation to new sources. And this adaptation, of course, that's the thing of being innovative. Think about new possibilities, how to new sources, new possibilities, how to survive. And because these cities with exponent beta bigger than one are the cities that are driven by innovation. So they should be capable of such a postponing of such a process. And they really do that. These are the ideal situation. This is the real data. It's from New York. You can see population and population growth. It's not the absolute numbers, but rate of growth. And we can see something like the cycles of growth. What is important, that if we look at this picture, we can see the cycles, but we can also see that these cycles are shorter and shorter. And that's maybe the other danger in this whole situation. Because the ways of technological changes, the ways of new adaptations must come faster and faster. the cities should accelerate more and more. And it's, of course, there is a question if there is some limit of that. It's quite interesting. On this small graph, you can see the time of the cycle. The period of the first cycle, innovation cycles, were about 40 years old, so let's say two generations. But when the size of city is growing, then these cycles drops to the, let's say, units 1, 2, 3 years. And that's probably the threshold of some sustainability. I'm not sure if the city can completely change the way of processing in every year, for example. Who will do that? Who will transfer the knowledge in such a time? So probably there is some limit. But in 20th century in New York, it worked. So that's the end, maybe the recapitulation. I wanted to show you some story about really transfer, real, exact, mathematically quantifiable transfer of knowledge between cities and living organisms. And if we again take this question, is there any such analogies? We, after this lecture, should say generally yes. Yes, for both of them, for urban systems and biological systems, size matters. All of their characteristics are related to size, and that's very important thing how to deal with them. This is important, that, and I think it's non-trivial. But if we look at this problem more detail, we should answer this question yes and no, because there are some phenomena which show significant similarities. Paradoxically, these phenomena are the least living, or these least life. You know, we share with the, we as a city, so cities share with the living organism things which are not living. The way how to distribute material resources, how to exchange the energy, how to structure transport systems. But there are also significant differences, and these differences are in social behavior, which is probably unique for cities. So that's the maybe the lesson from whole of this very trivial story. I'm apologizing for that, but I think it's a lesson from metaphors and analogies. I think the strength of the metaphors are not in that they somehow confirm what we have already known, but they somehow sometimes show us the exceptions from this universal law, the individual differences that make the particular system's characteristics. And probably these exceptions would be probably otherwise not come into the light than by this method. So, thank you very much.
To speak up, because I don't hear you very well.
Is the political regime already mentioned in this social behavior?
Political regime, you mean?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's quite interesting. Probably not, because as I told you, the data are from China, from United States, from European cities. So let's say very different political regimes there are, and the data so shows us the same behavior. So probably the politics it's not involved in the special. But it would be of course interesting. Definitely in structuring of cities, and I want to speak about it in second lecture. It's very influenced by the type of the planning of the city. Of course, in socialist regimes, it's something like something completely different than in the cities with free market and free market forces.
Do you maybe have some examples of the cities with potential infinite growth exponential?
No, I think all of them that are so somehow now concentrated on innovations. So New York, that was one example of it. But take probably every other city which is driven by IT technologies, social services, etc. So I hope most of the cities in Europe.
What about these like urban jungles as Rio or for example Lagos in Africa?
Mm-hmm.
Because here is also, I guess, they're really growing exponentially, but I think that if the beta set is greater than one, then here they're not driven by innovation, but maybe only the pollution, criminality is growing, and the innovation cannot sustain.
Yeah, I haven't been in Lagos, so I'm not sure how it is, but what I know, it's probably not the case of technological city.
Yeah.
But I think they are growing to cities like that in Africa or South Asia, or something like that. They're growing really fast, but I think it's the type of this exponential growth. They are just in this phase,
mm-hmm.
and the industrial cities in Europe are somewhere here, or here. That's the only difference. I think they are on the same curve. It's the same type of, similar type of cities, similar type of organization, only so.
You also mentioned collapse in case of such over exponential growth. Do you have any example? Any evidence is showing this? Do you have? What kind of collapse?
Probably, I don't know. But there are a lot of small collapses in New York. There were. The city was bankrupt several times, but in the city of New York they always had the chance or to somehow revive. The example of the death end of it. No, I'm not. But it's maybe the warning. Because this really are reason. This is the prediction just from the mathematical equations, and it's inevitable that if the growth is such that sometimes it will happen. So one of the possible solutions is this steadily postponing the crisis. We will see. The future is very interesting, and we will see what will happen.
Any other questions? Comments?
or in Europe went out.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think that this kind of development is also
be this shift to the
because those cities also need the same of kind of materials or so
it would be really nice. I'm not sure, but probably there is not such data yet to really observe mathematically the change in exponent beta in this transition from the industrial city to the technological one. Really. So the prediction is that it should somehow so be bigger and to grow the value of the exponent.
But do you think that it's possible, for example, if you now kind of try to focus only on one part, so this is the service economy, for example, that it can sustain itself without the material part, so without the other one?
This is always the question of proportion, and if I so speak about the technological systems, so I mean they are dominantly driven by services, but of course they need some material resources. We need gasoline stations and electric cables and etc. All this, of course, only it is not the so economically, let's say, dominant factor for this for life. So I hope you are not so tired as I am. But
okay.
Thank you. And
other questions?
Probably to the